Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, it's so good to see all of them tonight. In fact, the Lord is been a good day today.
Amen.
I see that big fish Jim caught. It's all I can do is hold it up. Let's all look to the Lord right now. Father, we love you tonight. We are thankful to be in the house of God. How good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Oh God, we need you more every day we live. Bless us, we pray. Lift us together in heavenly places. Open our hearts and minds unto you, God, and make this a house of worship tonight. Help us to lay aside every weight and the sin that does really beset us and press into that kingdom where is peace and joy and righteousness in the Holy Ghost. We'll thank you for it, Lord. Amen to God. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
All right. Judy.
Is that glass out there?
No.
Okay. It ain't glass.
It's a little loud. I once was lost in sin.
Here are famous crying, we will answer my
dark night in Egypt. A fearful time had come for one little Hebrew boy who was his father's firstborn son. But the angel of death was passing low. It was hard to fall asleep, but one little lamb stood in his mind as he lay there counting sheep. Thought of why the young lamb had to die, why his blood was on the door. Though the wind and rain, it still remained, but he wanted to be sure. So he called out to his earthly father with a trembling voice so scared, crying, "Father, will you please look and see if the blood is still there?" He said, "Son, now don't you worry, for the blood is there to stay.
City of gold. There'll be no dying up there. Yes, he is.
The Lord is good. Amen. I praise you. I want to sing another song here again. Lori Elms had a wonderful recording of this. I've heard a lot of people do it, but I believe she had one of the best recordings I ever heard. So. Last night I dreamed an angel came. He took my hand. He called my name. He bid me look the other way. We're having a really good time. I said, well, we miss you, but I'm glad you're having a good time. And they did have a beautiful wedding. They
yes,
really
they did.
And a big crowd, a lot of people. We almost didn't have enough to feed them all, frankly. But and they just kept making them mashed potatoes. And
Sister Ann kept pouring them drinks.
Sister Ann kept and it really helped her. I don't know what you'd done without her, but it was a blessing. I don't know. I'm in a serious mood tonight, and seemed like this week has been kind of a serious week, hasn't it?
Yes.
Kind of a week of examination. I thought about Brother Louis' message Thursday night about the dominion that's available to us over this earth, that God gave us dominion over this earth. And some of us are just not taking dominion. We're just not, you know, and it's, I sometimes wonder what we're going to have to do to get to where He wants us to be, you know. Sometimes people are just happy going to a church and sitting on a seat or putting their name on a roll somewhere. And the Bible said in that day they come up before me and say, I never knew you. And you know, well, you know me, surely. You know me. And they said, we did many mighty works in your name. We cast out devils. We healed the sick. And nowhere did he say, no, you didn't. He did not say it at all. He just said, I never knew you. And so all this week seemed like it's been a week of self-examination. Has been for me. I hope it has been for you. And a lot of things coming up in people's lives. And I'm going to tell you what, we wonder why these things happen to us. Folks, a lot of it is just self-examination. It's a time to examine ourselves. In fact, Paul said, examine yourself whether you be in the faith. Amen. And it's, so it's time for that examination. It's time to look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, and say, where do I really stand with God? And it's time to get serious. This is our life work, folks. And notice this, looking at over in the other patch. The berries we got right here in this patch right here. And you might as well quit looking over in the other patch. And think, well, I wish I had them big berries over there. Some of you heard me teach about that in Bible class many times, about how when I was a kid, we had to go get berries because we didn't buy jelly at the store. We didn't know what it was to have store-bought jelly.
No.
My mother made jelly. We went out with a wash tub and set it down in the berry patch, and we all had one-gallon bucket, the old paint buckets, all we turned to use, cleaned them out, and then paint. And go fill them up and come and dump them in the tub. We got a full wash tub. That's when we ready to take them home and have some berry dumplings. And Mama would make jelly and jam. And that's what we had.
Amen.
But I said this, I was young when I was real little, and we'd go generally early in the morning while it's cool before it got too hot. You know, in the blackberry patch it can get pretty hot. You know, and a lot of chiggers and all that out there. So we wanted to go early while it's still a little bit dew The sunlight was just glistening on them berries. And the berries on the other side of the bush was about that big. And here's these little dinky berries on this side. And so I'd run around to the other side. And come find out the berries on my side was that big, I guess. Because now these, it's an optical illusion the way, I guess. But I was continuing looking over at them other berries. And I go around that bush. And finally somebody told me, you pick them under your nose, you'll get along a lot quicker. Instead of looking over the other side of the bush, just pick the ones that's right under your nose. And when they're gone, go on around the bush. And you end up, and I finally figured that out's true. But see, you can always look over and say, well, I wish I had what they had, or I wish I could do what they do. And a lot of people go through life like that. Looking, and it's time to realize that we've been born into a kingdom. And in that kingdom, it's called the kingdom of God. Behold, and the kingdom of God is with men.
Amen.
It's been delivered unto us, and we have access to it, and we have to dominion, we have access to authority, we have access to deliverance, we have access to everything that God has available to us just simply by being born into the kingdom.
Amen.
Now, you know, Lisa's my daughter, and she don't have to do anything to be my daughter. She's born my daughter. I mean, sometimes that's good, sometimes it's not so good, but nevertheless, she is my daughter. And sometimes I must say, well, she ain't mud, but she's all I got.
You never did say
that.
Hallelujah. But I'm saying that to say that she's mine. She was born that. She doesn't have to do anything to be that. She hadn't been any special way. She never has, hardly, but she just is. And we are children of God. We are the sons of God. Amen. The Bible said, now are we. Someday I'm going to be. Oh, no. Right now are we the sons of God. We are the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. We're looking for something that hadn't yet appeared yet. But see, we got to claim it by faith. And as we claim it by faith, we grow into that sonship. Amen. Can you say amen?
Amen.
God has got a model for us, and we can grow into that model. But just because we don't have everything at our disposal or everything within us, evident for everybody to see, doesn't mean it's not available to us. It is available. Everything that God has is available to us. Hello? He gave us power to tread upon serpents. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Do you believe that word? The word says it. If you don't believe the word, I can't do much for you. But he gave us power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and every evil thing.
Yes.
Power of the enemy.
Amen.
Draw nigh unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. That's the dominion that we have. Everything's at our disposal. Amen.
Amen.
If we need money, well, let's go to the master. Ask of God, who giveth to all liberally and upbraideth not. That's what the word says. We don't have to go rob nobody.
Amen.
He's going to take care of us. Can you say amen?
Amen?
He always has. And I believe he always will. If we'll trust him and believe him. The Bible said if we'll trust him and obey him, we can eat the good of the land.
Yeah.
That means the best that there to offer. He's going to give it to us if we'll trust him and believe him. The old song says, trust and obey. There's no other way to be happy in Jesus. But somehow we'll spend half our life wanting this. You know, the children come up and they see mom and dad's got a house. Right now they think they ought to have a house. You know? And maybe it took mom and dad 30 or 40 years to get it. And a lot of struggling, a lot of doing without to get it. But they want it right now. And they want a car right now. Not just old Sugar, I want a nice car. And the next thing you know, they're head over heels in debt. And they wonder how they got there. End up having to file bankruptcy and lose their home. How many of you have seen do that? Yeah, because they... You know, they won't wait upon the Lord. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
And I know God's got it available to whosoever will. If you can believe it, you can have it. If you can visit, you can see it, you can claim it. You read it in the Word, you can have it. It's yours. But sometimes it doesn't come just overnight. And Paul said, I count not myself to have apprehended. But this one thing I do. I press toward the mark. For the prize. Children, there's a prize to be won.
Amen.
There's a prize. Somebody's going to win the prize.
Amen.
It's good to run the race, but somebody's going to win the prize.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I want the prize. I went far enough down the road that I've not been happy with everything that I've received in this life, but I know there's a prize waiting at the end of this thing, and I want the prize.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hey, hallelujah. And I've been waiting a long time. I got a feeling I don't have too much longer to wait. Hello. I got a feeling it's not too far off now that I'm going to enter in and get my prize. And I want to hear the Lord say, enter in, thou good and faithful servant of the Lord. You've been faithful in a few things. I'm going to make you ruler over many. And there's been many times you had to lay aside your desires, your hopes, and your dreams, and what you want for to do the will of God. Amen. Sister Nancy called me today about Brother Chuck, and I already had one in the nursing home that I'd been called to go see that was, near death. And they said, please go. And I did. I sat with her for a while, prayed with her, and held her hand, talked to her, and sung to her. And she, I don't know how much she knew, but I knew what I knew, and I could feel the presence of God. At the same time, I had an appointment with a lady at 2 o'clock. Messed my nap all up today. But half my spiritual life has been messed up by things that we got to do for God.
Yes.
Amen. But his agenda is number one. Can you say amen?
Right.
And this lady's getting ready to go out into glory. She's, well, I want you to do my funeral. I said, well, honey, you may get to do mine. I mean, we don't know. I said, did you hear Jennifer's message this morning? She was happened to be in the service this morning. But she's 89 years old, and she said, I want to make it clear. She said, I told Leon Summers, I put your name down. You're the one I want to do my funeral. And she said, Brother Potter had done her husband's funeral and several others of the family. But, of course, he's retired, and he's moved away now. And she said,
Brother Potter already went to believe in the Lord.
So you're the one. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I forgot about that. But anyway, she said, you're the one that I want to do this funeral. And I said, well, honey, you know, I'll be glad to do it. That won't be no problem at all. But I said, the fact of the matter is, as Jennifer preached to us this morning, if you heard her message, you might be 6 months, you might be 19, you might be 39, you might be 60, I forget the number she used, or you might be 91, or you might be 100. And you get your paper and you look and see, all of them wasn't just 65 or 75 or 85. Some of them was 19, some of them was 16, some of them was 11. For see, we have no promise of tomorrow. We don't know. Amen. When we're going to go out of here. But church, you're born. We got an appointment to keep, and that appointment is death. And we're all going to keep that appointment. We will not miss that appointment. Hello. Amen. But that place we're looking for is going to be much more than anything we've had in this life. And those that's been taught that, we know that and understand that very well. And I'm sure sometimes the transition may not be all that much fun, but by faith, and the closer I get, the more I believe it.
Amen.
I believe it stronger. The older I get, the more I'll be honest with you, I'm getting older. I think about it. I do think about it. And sometimes at night, I'll lay in bed and talk to God about it. But I'm really not really afraid of it, and that's the truth. And I'm glad of that. I'm not in fear of death. I'm really not at all. Amen. I've got a lot to do. I'm not in a hurry to run out of here. I don't have a death wish. But I'll be honest with you, I'm not afraid.
Amen.
I'm not afraid. I've looked over into the promised land, as Martin Luther King said. I've seen the promised land. I know what's waiting over there. I mean, I just got a glimpse of it. And I know I haven't seen the half that hadn't been told what's waiting on me over there. Hallelujah. Amen. And I believe it's going to be more than it's cracked up to be. I believe it's going to be worth every trial and every test and everything that we've been through.
Yes.
But it's time for people to wake out of sleep. Wake out of that dream that you're in. This is it. This is the world. This is the way that it is. Someone was talking the other day about how I used to tell about when I got married, and I looked up and I had a bunch of little kids. And they'll come pretty quick if you ain't careful. Bam, 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 bam. Every 2 years I had a kid. By the time I was 19 years old, I had a bunch of them.
By the time he's 21, you had five.
Yeah, by 21 years old, I had five. And over there. Let me tell you, they'll just keep coming. They'll just keep coming. Amen. And I said, I used to think that you just go to the refrigerator and there's milk in there. And then I found out I had to put it there. Boy, that was a shock to me. I thought the milk fairy put that in there. I thought it was just automatic. You know, the peanut butter and the jelly, just go get it. I mean, that's what I always did. I never give no thought about it. I want a jelly sandwich. I just went and got it. It was there. Poor old man of mine, my old man, he worked his brains out, worked his fingers to the bone to put that peanut butter and that jelly there. But I'll be honest with you, it wasn't until I really come to understand that he absolutely put that there. And I'm so thankful for the time that I had with him the last 2 years of his life. But I'd sit and tell him, Dad, I want you to know something. I appreciate every sacrifice that you ever made for me. I used to sit and tell him that by the hour. I'd sit and tell him, I want you to know, Dad, I've got five little kids and I worked at Ford Motor Company. And so I made pretty good money. And I said, I can't hardly make it, and I don't know how you did it. And then I'd say, oh, yes, I know how you did it. You did without a lot. I'm not stupid. I know. Amen. I wasn't born for a motor company. I worked at Brickyards and Zero Weather. And yeah, I paid my dues on that. But one day I ended up, I looked up and I was at Ford Motor Company. I was like, good Lord, I didn't know they paid people the money that I was making up there. What I'm saying is I paid my dues. And I know what it is to struggle for every meal and you know, wonder how you're going to get by. But I got the chance to be with my dad and tell him, look him in the eye, and I said, Dad, I want you to know something. I want to tell you right now, I appreciate everything you've done without to see that I had. And big tears rolled down his face, bless his own heart. And I know he thought he'd never hear those words from one of his kids, but he heard it from me. And I just hugged him and loved him and pet on him. And because I meant it, I understood what he must have went through. And I'll tell you what, we didn't do without very much. We had a house full of kids, but there was always food on that table. Amen. And I know, I've told this before, we worked a 4-acre field one time, a garden with hoes.
Oh, yeah.
A bunch of kids. Well, 4 acres we put out there. And I'll tell you, we had potatoes. In the wintertime, we had potatoes. And we had canned tomatoes, and we had green beans, and we did not go hungry. We had what we needed, praise the Lord.
Amen.
But he was willing to hit the lick and do the thing that it took to get it done. And that was no easy thing. I can just imagine the days he said, oh my God, I've got to go in there again today. I can remember many times working on an old brickyard. There was a wind whipping across that brickyard. Sometimes in the wintertime, they were slow. There wasn't very much to do. We'd almost beg for a truck to come in to get a load because we'd stand out there freezing to death, just sorting brick, just pinning around, putting in time. Amen. And just wish we didn't have to be there. I mean, some miserable, miserable days. And a Levi jacket, bend over, and my back was bare. And I'd scrape that snow over them bricks sometimes. Oh, pick up a tongue full of brick and it's all fly apart because it's had ice all over it and hit your foot. And every time you turn around, you hit that same foot. I can't tell you how many times I did that. Some miserable, miserable, long, long days. And it made me understand what my dad suffered through. And your dad was there, Brother Roger, Willie Morgan. My dad loved your dad. He just thought the world of Willie Morgan. Praise the Lord. Oh, yeah, we go back a long, long ways. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord God. But let me tell you something, children. Amen. We've got to make preparations to go where I'm talking about going. There has to be some preparations made. Amen. They've talked about it this week in the ministry. Just about every time I turn around, it's time to get serious. It's time to get down to business. It's time to quit looking at what other people's doing. Amen. And start looking, amen, and comparing ourselves with Jesus. Am I a Christian? Am I really what I ought to be? Am I walking where I really ought to be walking? Am I gonna make it in? Am I ready to go? Generally, it's self-examination time. And I believe it's time that men wake out of sleep. Hallelujah. And I believe the Spirit is calling us to those things right now. Hallelujah. For a self-examination about where we stand with God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to read to you in the 7th chapter of St. Luke if you turn with me. Amen. And I'm going to read just a little bit here. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city which was a sinner. Oh yeah, he'll use sinners. Oh, God won't use them. Oh yes, he will. He'll use whoever he wants to use. Hallelujah. But I got news for you. He loves a sinner. Amen. He's married to the backslider. God don't give up. See, God loves. Amen. Just because you got some good, you may not want to deal with sinners anymore. God still loves them. Hallelujah. Amen. He wants to save them. He wants them to change, but he still loves them. Don't you doubt that. And it said, so they asked him into their house and said unto me, and behold this woman, which was a sinner. When she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him, weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet and anointed them with the anointment. I'm going to tell you something. This girl realized she was in the presence of royalty. She realized there was someone very special in her midst. Now, I'm sure she didn't fully understand it, but she knew that she was in the presence of something bigger than her. Folks, you're going to have to understand something. We're serving something that's bigger than we are. It's more important than our little agendas that we have. It's more important than our everyday humdrum life that we fight against. And sometimes we'll make that the issue. But the issue is the kingdom of God. Amen. That's really the important thing. All our little wants and desires. I've said this before that I preached a message here one time about phantoms. How we chase after phantoms. We go through life chasing after phantoms. Phantoms of things that we would like to have. And they're so elusive because when we get to it, it wasn't what we thought it was going to be. It's not all that it's cracked up to be. I'm going to tell you, a lot of what devil tries to tempt you with is not all that it's cracked up to be. It don't take you long to find that out. But after you do, then you load it down with a few kids and a lot of bills. When you come to the knowledge that really not all that it's cracked up to be. I'm going to tell you something. A little that a good man has is better than the riches of many wicked. You understand that? God knows how to bless. And his blessings are true blessings. There's not a lien on his blessings. When you got a blessing from God, you got a clear title to it. There's no lien on it. Oh, we can have a lot of things in this world, but somebody's got a claim on it. Somebody's got a lien on it. It don't really fully belong to you. The government will come in and tell you what to do with it. Or they'll tell you this, that, and the other. Or they'll put restrictions on it. And you know what I mean? You really find out when you have to deal with the government just how much you really have God. And you ain't got nothing that can't disappear overnight.
That's right.
Some have found that out in the last few months, haven't they?
Yep.
Hallelujah. But folks, that place that we're seeking for, Amen. Those treasures that we're sitting up there, they're going to be laid up. Amen. The rust can't get in. The thieves can't get in and steal. Nobody can take it from you. Amen. It's going to be waiting on you. Hallelujah. And it's going to be multiplied. There's going to be a lot of interest on that that's laid up. Amen. All that God has is going to be at your disposal. And I had not seen, ear had not heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them that love Him.
Amen.
Do you believe what I'm saying to you? I wonder sometimes if we do the way that we live, whether we really believe it or not. It's time to believe it. See, a promise is only good if you believe it.
Amen.
If you don't believe it, you can have 50,000 promises, but if you don't believe them, they're no good to you.
Amen.
But God's promises are true.
Amen.
Sister Jennifer preached it so well this morning. I've never seen, said I'm old, David said, and I've been young, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. He takes care of us. Sometimes we don't even give him, amen, the honor that he should have. Because we think we did it.
No.
We think we did it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. No. I remember I was working on the working at Ford Motor Company. And next thing you know, they went on strike. And so my boss that used to own the brickyard called me and said, I saw where you guys went on strike last night. Yeah, I said, I guess so. I didn't go in. I was supposed to go in. I sat and watched it on TV. They were supposed to be going in and walking out. That's what I seen. We walked out, yeah. Well, they said, what are you going to do? Well, I said, I've been working 7 days a week. I really need some time off. I didn't really take the care. Yeah, about coming down and working for me while you're off. And I said, well, I said, what hours I'll be working? What hours do you want to work? I said, 8 to 5. He said, well, whatever you want to work. He said, so he had me all set up. I made samples. I worked in the sample room. We were making samples. Had a little radio. I had a coffee pot. Had my own little office there. And so I kind of liked that. And he liked me. And so that's what I did. We was on strike for 10 weeks. And I worked up at the brickyard all that time. And now my pay went way down, you know, to what it had been. And you know what? I couldn't see a bit of difference. God just made up the difference.
Amen.
And just life just rolled right on. And really, if you want to know the truth, I had to time the line. I got to see a lot of guys I hadn't seen in a long time. And God just took care. He just takes care. Don't you, Brother Bobby? Brother Bobby, he left his job and he was working on his own. And you know, God just filled it in, just took care of it. And now he had to offer himself. He had to get out and hustle a little bit. And had to do whatever he had to do. But guess what? God brought you through, didn't he? Amen. I don't see that you, look like you still growing in grace and knowledge and other ways. Hallelujah. God's good. Now, it's awful good to get back and say, hallelujah, thank God I'm back, right? Amen. And then he'll give you more than what you had in the beginning. He always does. He always has, hasn't he? That's what he did to Job. Amen. He gave a lot more than what he had in the beginning. But Job was willing. And Job believed God and he trusted God.
Amen.
Said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
And his wife, even his wife, said, why don't you just curse God and die? Why? I said, you talk like a foolish woman.
Amen.
You don't know what you're saying. God's good. Now I'll tell you what. And when he was lonely, he said, oh, God, I don't understand what this happened to me. He moaned and cried. Some people say you can't question God. Oh, yes, you can. Go ahead.
Sure.
Question. He just moaned and hit your head on the wall and everything. Lord, I just don't know why I'm going through all this. But when anybody else around you say, God's good, let me tell you this. He's going to take care of me. Don't you worry about me. Amen. I'm going to be all right. Hallelujah. Because God is going to take care of me.
Right.
And I'll tell you, you trust God and he'll take you through. Amen. He'll come, cause people to come and lay things at your feet. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
If you trust him and believe him. Well, we heard that message preached this morning. I don't want to get back on that message this morning. I couldn't preach it like Jennifer did. It was so, so good.
Amen.
The word of God was so rich. And Louis' message Thursday night was just tremendous. And I believe God is calling all of us to examine ourselves. I heard Brother Roger said that he's going to make a commitment. He's making a commitment.
Yes.
Brother Roger, my heart jumped.
Yes.
My heart jumped. I wanted you to make that commitment so long because you're special.
Amen.
You're a special person. I've always known you're special. Even if you don't know it, I know it because God caused that to be so. And he set his love upon you. Hallelujah to God. I know when the whole family was in this church, all of them was in here. All them kids was in here, and the enemy was in here, and I'll tell you what. And it just kind of drifted away because they didn't make a commitment, see. They just fell in the seat. They didn't really make a commitment. But I heard you made a commitment. Somewhere along the line, you got to make a commitment. I don't care what others do. I'm going to serve God. I don't care what the devil tries. He can't stop me. I don't care what people say. They can't hurt me. I don't care what others do. I must go on. And that has to be our commitment unto God. Now, I'm going to tell you something, children. People fight that commitment. They try to put it off. They try to get around it. And every way they turn. And it's just in one struggle after another. In one struggle after another. But when you make a commitment, when you say, I'm going to do this thing, something magical happens. All of the elements of God's work begins to come together and go to work for you. I'm telling you what I know. Because I know there was a time I was on that fence. And I couldn't seem to go forward. And I knew I couldn't go backward. Because I've been back there. And there ain't nothing back there. And I just on the fence. I couldn't be committed. And I struggled and I fought and I struggled. And I was up and I was down and I was in and I was out. And I saved on Saturday and lost on Wednesday. And saved on Sunday and lost, on Wednesday. And it just happened over and over and over. And finally I got sick and tired of that situation. That lack of security. I wanted the security. Did you ever hear the eternal security of the believer? The Baptists talk about it a lot. It's a good thing. They may not even fully understand what they're talking about sometimes, but I do. I know what it means to be eternally secure in God. That means you're prayed up, you're stayed up, amen, and you're continually going before the Lord, keeping those sins under the blood, taking them before the Lord daily, erasing that board every day. Boy, can you say amen? Amen. Getting up in the morning and say, Lord, walk with me today. Go with me today. Keep my mouth. Don't let me think evil thoughts. Keep my mind stayed upon you. Sing a song in my heart. Fill my heart with joy. Give me a reason to live. And lay down at night and say, thank you, Lord, for another day. If I have wounded any soul today, if I have walked in my own selfish way, oh, Lord, forgive.
Yes.
And we keep that under that blood.
Amen.
Amen. And we don't look at other people and judge them. Who art thou, man, and judge another? To his own God he standeth or falleth.
Amen.
Amen. You see, there's an old song that said, if you don't go tell my brother, don't tell another, just go and tell Jesus on me.
Amen.
And I believe that. I believe you get too caught up in that stuff, passing that stuff around. It'll tear you down. It'll destroy you. And it'll cause you when you really need grace, because your heart is full of guilt because of some of the things you said and thought, then you can't really approach God like you should. But if you've got clean hands, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? He that hath clean hands. He that hath not spoken deceitfully. He that hath spoken evil things against his neighbor. Yeah, you can ascend that hill of the Lord if your heart's right with God.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you what we need more than anything else, children, is to get our heart right with God.
Come on.
And I'm not talking about not being concerned about other people. I'm just saying keep your mouth shut.
Right.
Keep your mouth off of them. Amen. Hallelujah.
Preach
on. Judge yourself. Need not to be judged.
Amen.
Amen. That's right. If you judge yourself, you won't need to be judged. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And we want to judge ourselves. Let's judge ourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I want to be like you. I want to think the way you would think. I want to look at things the way you would want me to look at things. Amen. I'm not going to try to figure out everything that people do and what they do and why they do what they do. It's too big, it's too high for me, it's too wide for me, it's too low for me. Amen. But I'm just going to seek you in my life. Hallelujah. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. I'm trying to get into this and I have the hardest time.
39.
But anyway, now when the Pharisees which had bidden him saw it, He spake within himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that touches him, for she is a sinner. Now, right away, people start judging things. One of the things that we've heard in Pentecost for years and years, we don't hear too much around here because we taught against it for so many years. Well, the reason they're in that shape is because they've sinned, or they've done this, or they've done that, or done the other. That kind of doctrine is out of the lake of fire. That's not of God. Amen. We all fight our battles, and amen. And there's no need trying to figure out necessarily, amen. Yeah, you can question God, and if you're on the wrong track, I believe God can get you back on the right track. I believe that. But I don't believe we're going through things for something we did. I don't believe that. No. I don't believe all these flood victims are so bad and that's why they lost their home. I don't believe that kind of thing. That's trash. I don't believe that. It rains on the just and the unjust. And bad things happen to good people. What do you think about our Lord? The Bible said he was without sin. He never did anything to anybody. Look what they did to him. The Bible said he was a man who went about doing good. That's all he did, was went around doing good, and they crucified him. Hallelujah. So I don't know what you have to face before you die. But I know one thing, you got to go in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You got to go as a child of God, and you have to go as a child of dominion.
Yes.
Amen. You got to take authority over everything around you. You got to stand for something. If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything.
Amen.
You got to stand for something.
That's right.
Absolutely.
Hallelujah.
Come on, brother. Oh, Jamal. You know, I never will forget, I was working at Ford Motor Company, as a matter of fact, young in my ministry. And had a man come and tell me, he was talking about some black people. Of course, there's a lot of black people in there, and there was no problem for me. I was raised on a black man's lap, so race was no problem for me. A lot of people don't understand that, but Albert Merritt was just like my grandpa or something. I mean, he gave me money. I wouldn't even have any spending money if he didn't. It always tickles me, these people around town, that they do these things honoring Doc Merritt, you know, and so forth. Most of them wouldn't even have him in their home. They wouldn't even associate with him. They didn't know nothing about him. I can tell you, I know something about him. I used to walk him over to the club every night, go over and meet him. And when he got through his supper at the Marshall Sanitarium, I'd meet him over and walk him. Here we go, walking on. He just shuffled along, you know. Had a little black doggy with a little shorty. And I loved Doc, and he was... I admired him. I looked up to him. Amen. He devoted his whole life to white boys. Poor white boys. He gave himself absolutely to poor white boys in this city. Can you think about that? He had a boys' club. And my dad was a member of that club. And when I became, I was 12, maybe 13, before you could become a member.
Darrell Island.
And
Highland and Marion Street.
And I can tell you that I was initiated in that club, and to this day I've never told anybody that initiation. Never will. Secret.
Secret.
Secret initiation. No. And I told his
aunt.
No, I wouldn't tell him.
Yeah.
They swore me to secrecy on initiation, and it was a silly little old thing.
You know, Brother Pat, I never met the man, but I love him just for what you said.
He was a wonderful man.
Yes.
And he honored everybody. And he had the respect of the people of Martinsville. He was a very special individual. And he spent his life trying to cause boys to do the right thing and walk the right path at a time, you know, when a lot of them didn't have that guidance. Oh, and they get in a big argument, he'd get them boxing gloves out. And there's them great big old heavy, I mean, boxing gloves, a little kid come up to here. I mean, you could beat somebody to death with them, not hurting. And then they get in a big argument and they want to fight each other. You want to fight? Let's do it right. Let's put the gloves on. And he put the gloves on. And little kids, they just play against each other. Then they wear each other out, you know. it brings pleasant thoughts back to my life.
Amen.
Because we had a lot of things we wouldn't have hadn't been for old Doc Merritt. And I know he took a lot of his own money. And later years, as people donated money to him, he got money from all over the country. And there was great people like Fred Waring and Jimmy Dranny and a lot of Hollywood people that came around and donated their time and donated money. And they stayed down at that sanitarium and bathed in them mineral springs. And I remember we used to sing to them. They would come in. Doctor said, come on in, we got some visitors. Here there'd be a whole room full of them. And they'd stand some of those little ones on the chairs. We'd sing, there is going to be a million in the year in the sweet, sweet by and by. Dirty faces and someone with no shirts on and
Wally always had
holes in the knees of her pants. And found out in later years who it was that we met. Didn't even know who they was. But we read it in magazines and things in later years. I don't know how I got on that, but you know, a lot of people didn't know who they had among them. But they will someday. Yeah. They will someday. Come to Martinsville when he was 19 years old.
Nope.
Devoted his whole life. He was almost 100 years old when he died. Praise the Lord.
Yep.
Oh, blessed Jesus. Hallelujah. Where am I at here?
40.
All right. And Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he said, Master, say on. You know, most times God's got something he wants to get to us. A lot of the situations we go through and we're into is because God is trying to teach us something. You can always look back and say, yes, sir, God was here and he was here and he was here. But at the time, you don't see him nowhere. Lord, where are you? If you're in this, where are you at? But I guarantee you'll look back and you'll say, yes, sir, God was in this and he was in this and he was in this. And you'll see that he was there all the time. Hallelujah. Said he went on to say there was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore which of them will love him the most. Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said to him, thou hast rightly judged. You know, some of us have had a hard time accepting the grace that God has provided for us. Because we know what we were. We know where we came from. We knew if we'd got our just deserts, we wouldn't even be able to stand before Him. We wouldn't even be able to praise His name. Huh?
Amen.
But who's the most thankful? I'll tell you who it is. The one that's been forgiven the most. That's who. Paul said, I know what I was. I know what I am. Even a sinner saved by grace, an apostle called out of due season, not fit to be called an apostle. He knew, you know, his shortcomings. Folks, and you know, if you're not careful, you'll let those shortcomings keep you from attaining what God has for you. But it has nothing to do with those things. Because the Father loved you and set his love upon you. That's why you're here saved tonight.
Amen.
Because God loved you. And he gave himself. And there's something about us, we just can't believe that I'm that lovable. And for the most part, most of us are not that lovable. But he loves us anyhow, Brother Roger. And I tell you, we can go through this thing, and I know you've been down this road, and I have, and most of us have. You know, and trying to fit in or trying to get a hold of whatever it is. Some of these people got something I just don't seem to have. And what it is the acceptance of God's grace. I came to a crossroads one time in my life, and I knew that if I didn't get over this thing, I would never be able to make it, because I had judgment put on myself. I didn't measure up. I knew that I didn't measure up, and I didn't know of anything I could make myself to do to measure up. You know what I mean?
Amen.
And I dare say most of us have had that attitude somewhere along the way.
Amen.
But I found out something. That he loved me unequivocally. He loved me simply because he loved me. My mother used to say this, and some of you heard her stand right here in this church and say this. Why he ever saved me, I don't know.
The worst he got.
The worst one in the bunch, she'd say. Raised in a house full of thieves and bootleggers. It's all drunks and thieves. And she's a pretty good drinker too. She can drink like a sailor. And cuss you to dog rags in a minute. I mean, she's, and out of all that family, she's the only one for many, many years. And little by little, she brought several of them in. But out of my whole house, even her mom and dad didn't know the Lord. Wasn't raised in a praying family. Didn't know. She said, well, I didn't think there's anything wrong with stealing. We was all thieves. It's a way of life. Everybody did it. She said, I found out everybody didn't do it.
Yes.
And I found out God didn't want me to do it. And so she struggled along and struggled along and struggled along for many, many years before she really found grace in God. And I understand. Because I come to that crossroads one time. But I found grace. And I tell you, I failed God real bad. I let the church down. I let a lot of people down that loved me. I really thought my ministry was gone forever, would never come back again. I'm serious with you. Because back in those days, you didn't do the way we did and make it. Because they'd work against you. They'd just see to it that you never get back on your feet. But the grace of God appeared. The grace of God appeared. Amen. And he said, don't worry about what anybody thinks or anybody says. Yeah. And I've had some come and tell me, give me every reason why I shouldn't be doing this. You got no right to do this. And I said, well, you're not God.
That's right.
I had to say that to some people.
Right.
I'm sorry, but you're not God. You don't know what God told me. I wouldn't do this for anybody but the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Dude, there are a lot of things I'd rather be doing. But I'm constrained. Woe is me if I preach not the gospel. I'm a prisoner of the Lord Jesus. Now what am I going to do? Am I going to obey you or obey God? You be the judge. I think Peter said that one time, didn't he?
Amen.
Whether we should hearken unto you or hearken unto God, you be the judge. And I had to come to that place myself. Amen. I didn't have no fellowship. I was just fellowship. I had no support. Everybody was against me, and I'm calling on my life, and God wouldn't let me get out of it. I tried to get out of it. I tried every way to get out of it. I was so willing to go and just pick and sing for anybody who would let me, but that wasn't enough. God wanted me to minister. He said, I've got people like you out there that's been hurt in churches, and they need you. They need you to bring them together. And he said, I'm going to give you a ministry of reconciliation. He told me those very words. Standing right here in this church, one of the first times I walked through this door, he said, my son, I give unto you a ministry of reconciliation. I didn't even know what it was. I had to go get a dictionary and see what reconciliation was. I had no idea. But God spoke those words to me. Amen. I know what it's all about tonight. And I've had many come. And some don't stay. They come in, they get filled, God restores them and gives them back their ministry, and they go on out and do their ministry. It used to bother me. I want to keep every one of them, see? Especially them good tithe prayers, I want to keep them, you know. They, a lot of them come in, went out, took their tithes, went on out.
Yeah.
But you know what? I finally come to a place that don't matter to me because the saints don't belong to me. They belong to God.
Amen.
They're His children. They're His children. He just give me a... You know, let me be the watchdog for a while. Kind of watch over them. Tend them a little bit. Tend the sheep. Amen. You can't own them now. They're not yours. But you tend them now. Don't you take advantage of them. Don't you mistreat them now. Don't you. Now, they're my children now. Huh? You ever somebody babysit with your kids and come to find out they mistreat them? We're ready to fight, ain't we? Mistreat my kid.
Our little darling,
they can't do no wrong, can they? Now, don't you think the Lord ain't jealous for His children, too?
Amen.
We got to treat you right. Amen. Now, we might have to stand against you sometimes, but we have to say, I'm sorry, you're wrong. I hate to disagree with you, but you're wrong. And sometimes that does happen. And people don't like to be told they're wrong when they're wrong. And, you know, and that we have problems. But I still keep in mind one thing. The children of God belong to God. They're His children.
Amen.
They're His children. He knows how to whip them in line, I'll tell you that. If you've never been whipped in line with the Lord, you ain't lived yet. And He's a good father. He don't let you get by.
Amen.
You got a licking coming, He'll see that you get it. Oh, yes, He's a good father. Hallelujah. But I'm glad it's out of way.
Amen.
I'm glad it's out of way. And I know necessity is laid upon me. I thought about this sister that came before the Lord there. And she was just full of such adoration. And she wanted to worship and adore Him. And she got down and washed His feet with her tears. And He was so moved. Because He knew that really within herself, she didn't even feel worthy to do what she did. She knew She had the guilt in her heart. She knew where she was at. She knew what she was all about. But she cast that aside because of her love for him. And he was moved by that. I'm going to tell you something. You may worry about your shortcomings. And I'm not a good Christian as like some of them. I'm sure the devil's told you that. Sure he has. He's a liar and the father of it. But see, he's not the judge of it anymore than I am. God's the one that judges you. He's your judge. He's the one. Amen. And I'll tell you what he said. He whispered to you, said, don't give up. Don't give up. Just keep on coming. Keep on coming. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up now. Just keep on. Keep trying. Keep trying. It's going to happen for you. God's going to make a way for you. He's going to bring victory your way. Don't give up. Oh, you know, I'm struggling with this. Just keep on struggling. Hold on to God. Do what you can. Take what you got. Do the best you can with it. Oh, you may not do as good as somebody else has done, but you do your best. Don't worry about it. There is a people that judge themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, and these people are not wise. Come on, look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. He is faithful. He called you, and he's faithful to bring it about in your life if you can only believe. If you can only believe. Hallelujah. Sister Carol got deliverance after 45 years. And now she's suffering from some of the after effects.
And the choices, that's right.
The choices she made in hurting her body. And we know God can change that. God can change that. We know he can. And I was telling Daisy was talking about it, and I said, well, you know, Daisy, really for her age, she's pretty good shape. Compared to a lot of people, a lot of times when people got things like that, they got 45 other things they're dealing with, and it caused them not to be able to be strong like they want to be. But she's a pretty strong lady.
She's a pretty lady.
She's a pretty lady. She's strong, and she's had to push through. She's had to push through when others would quit. She's had to deny herself and push through. That's going to help you get victory. That's going to help you get what you need from God. Because you're willing. You're just pushing on. She's here tonight. There'd be some people sitting in the dark room feeling service up tonight.
Yes, he would.
Just give up. I give up. I give up. What good did it ever do to give up on anything?
Never.
Amen. We started in with Jesus. The song said, I'm going through. I'm going through. I'm going through. I'll pay the price whatever others do. I'll take the way with the Lord despised few. Started in with Jesus and I'm going through. There has to be a mindset. I'm going through. Can't stop me. Amen. Can't stop me, Satan. You might as well give up. Go talk to somebody else. You ain't stopping me. I've come too far down the road. I'm going through.
Amen.
Hallelujah. She's going to have a new body. Pray the Lord will have a new life. Isn't that right?
Amen.
Yep. I thought about this sister. It got beyond her own judgment of herself. Amen. She got beyond that to the point she just wanted to worship God.
Mm-hmm. Worship God.
They say, no, he'll use your imperfections against you to keep you from even worshiping or praying. When you feel worthy to pray, open your mouth. You know, because Satan said, boy, you're a good one. You ought to pray. Look, you got this and you got that. He's such a liar. He'll keep you from, but you know, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Do you know who God loves the most tonight? You want to know really, truly, tonight, this very night, who God loves the most? The one that needs him the most. The one that is in the most need. The weakest one in the bunch within themselves, I'm talking about. They may be a lot stronger than they think they are, but within themselves, they just don't measure up. They're just weak. That's the one the Lord loves the most. He'll go off and leave the 99 and go out after that one's lost. In fact, if you're not careful, you'll sit and be jealous about how much attention somebody's getting because they're going through things. But they need that attention. They've got to have it. Now, come on, just say, bless the Lord, and go on. He'll get back to you when you need it real bad. He'll get back to you. He'll wipe your nose when you need it, right? Amen. It got good tonight.
Yes,
it
is.
His promises are true. Amen. We can stand upon his word. We can believe him. And we got to get past our own inabilities and our own weaknesses to the point that we can worship God. That's all he wants from us, children. He wants your praise. He wants your honor. He wants you to worship him. Lord, here I am. You know me. Roger, he knows you. He knows all about you. I don't know why I'm talking to you now, but I'm going to talk to you now. Because I've been through your struggle. I know what it is. And Satan's already trying to figure out, well, we'll see about this commitment deal. We'll see if we can stop this thing.
Yeah.
Because I know how he is. Amen. You just got to say, look, I don't care. I don't care. Here I am. I remember one time I sat in the church. I had just failed God miserably. Was in a terrible situation. Sitting in a church. I didn't feel worthy to take any part whatsoever. And I said, well, half the church world thinks I'm lost. I guess maybe I am. I don't know. But I just love to go to church. And I love, that's where I wanted to be.
Love God.
And I go out and play in the club till 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning and go home and get up at 9 and go to Sunday school. Because that's what I love. That's what I wanted to do. And I go and sit. And sometimes a preacher try to get me to take part, and I, oh, no, just leave me alone. Let me heal. And God just, he blessed me. And I found out what grace was all about. I said, well, Lord, I'm going to go to hell, just about soon go to hell sitting here in this church as anywhere else, because this is really where I want to be. And so I find a good place. I don't care what people think or what they say, what their imagination is. I'm here for one reason. That's because I love you, and that's it.
Amen.
And you know what he did? He restored me.
Absolutely.
He forgave my sin. He lifted me up, restored my ministry, gave it all back to me. Amen to God. And I understand his grace today. I truly, fully understand the grace of God. And I know it's not within any of my goodness or your goodness or anybody's else, but just simply because he loved me. Now, I still don't understand it, but I accept it.
Amen.
I believe it. I love you, made a believer out of me. I believe you do love me, Lord. And I love him so much. And I find myself these days, waking in the night, saying, Lord, I just love you. Lord, I thank you that you restored my ministry. I thank you, Lord, that you've given me work to do. Yeah, sometimes I lay way up in the night just talking to him like that. I really, really do appreciate you, Lord, more every day that I live. Hallelujah. Your grace, your mercy. Thank you for my wife. She's the best friend I got. I can really depend on her. She's always there for me. That's her heart. She does everything she can. Sister Jennifer, I try to help me down the road. She sees something that's going to be a burden for me. She'll just try to get to go ahead and do it. She's not very well herself. But she does that. Amen. I appreciate that. Some of you have been so kind to me and done so many. Was over at Steak and Shake the other night, and Brother Gene come picked up the tab.
Yep.
It was so sweet of you, Brother Gene. I said, yeah. Oh, you don't have to do that. I know. But he just wanted to do something nice for me. Isn't that nice?
Amen.
Hey, it's nice. Try it sometime.
Oh,
not necessarily me, but somebody.
You're rattling.
But it is. It's time. It's the love of God. Oh, thank God for the love of God. How rich and how pure the love of God is tonight. Children, I love him. I hope you heard the voice of God tonight. I've been hearing it all week.
Yes.
And I've been in a kind of a self-examination type of a mode.
Yes.
And I've been saying to myself, Lord, amen, help me not to judge people.
Bye-bye.
Amen, help me to see them through the eyes of grace as you look upon them. They're your children.
Yes.
They are. They're worth something.
I don't blame
them. I don't know what he thought was worth, Brother Bobby, but he saw something, didn't he?
Yeah.
I'm so thankful. As I watch the ministers in this church, Sister June did such a nice job after Sunday school this morning.
Yes, she did.
Just put the icing on the old cake this morning. I'm so proud. I'm so proud of all of our ministers. Amen. God is using. I just wouldn't be surprised at anything he does. I thank you. I thank you for your love. I thank Brother Bob Weimer for his love.
Yes.
He loves me. If I am the old Pentecostal, he loves me anyhow. He's a... still trying to, help me to find
grace.
Oh, pray for me, brother. I can use all I can get, I'll tell you that. Lord, Ronnie, come and rescue me.
All right.